If you're excited about Jesus Christ, let me hear you say, hey, praise God, amen. We're a Christ-centered organization, and we want to see lives change. And we know that the gospel of Jesus Christ is where life change happens. Reaching the hard to reach with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We want to see you raise your kids in the church house and not the dope house. Amen.
1 John chapter 2, verse 28. And if you'd bow your heads with me, please, we'll pray together. Father, we thank you, Lord, tonight for your grace and mercy. I thank you, Lord, tonight that you're a good God, a merciful God, that you can do what no man can do, what no program can do, what no therapy can do, what no medicine can do. That God, that you can bring dead things to life. And I pray as we talk about Jesus coming back and the anticipation of that, God, as Christians, that you would move in this place in a mighty way. And those who do not know Jesus Christ would realize that when he comes, Lord, it's over. That Father, that their anticipation, God, should prove that they're waiting on Jesus Christ. That Father, there are some in this room that do not have confidence that they know Jesus. And there's some in this room that claim to know God without having a relationship with the Son. And I just ask, God, that you would bring heavy conviction in this place tonight. And there would be real life salvation in this place, God, that you would move. I pray that you would encourage the brethren tonight. I pray that those who know Jesus Christ would be stirred just to live for him more and more, be sanctified more and more, and just grow in the knowledge of Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. 1 John chapter 2, verse 28. And now, little children, abide in him. That when he appears, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. If you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone who practices righteousness is born of him. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us. That word bestowed means lavished. What manner of love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God. Therefore, the world does not know us, but because it did not know him. Beloved, now we are children of God. It has not yet been revealed what we shall be. But we shall know that when he is revealed, but we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And everyone who has this hope in him, Jesus, who has this hope in Jesus, purifies himself as he is pure. Have you ever anticipated someone's arrival? Hurry up and wait. You ever heard that phrase? Have you ever just thought about somebody when they're going to come? Maybe it's somebody who is in a military family tonight, and you grew up in a military family. Maybe it was your dad or your mom who was serving this country and gone for a period of time. But you just thought, man, I can't wait. It's getting close to the day where they come back home again. Maybe tonight. Someone, when you go on a vacation or someone's left on a work, maybe traveling, working or something. And you know, when they come back, you can't wait to see them. My wife just left for Georgia. And man, I can't wait to see her. She left today to visit Ashland. And when she comes back, I'll be excited for her return. And so the Apostle John in this letter, the Apostle John is disputing the corrupt teaching of these men, these men, probably women, who come from the church. In 1 John chapter 2, it says, they went out from us because they were not of us. And so he began to talk about these people. And these people made claims. If you read 1 John chapter 1, you'll see they made these claims. John says this, he says, if we say we have no sin, that was the claims of the false teachers, then we're a liar. He's saying those people who say that are liars. And if we say we've never sinned, we make God a liar, and the truth is not in us. And so as he begins to discredit them, and so he's writing this letter to these people in the church of Jesus Christ who have not been taken away with this corruption and false teachers. In 1 John chapter 2, verse 20 and 27, he says, you have the anointing from God and you know the truth. He says, I'm not writing these things to you that you don't know because you don't know, but because you do know the truth, you have an anointing from God that teaches you. What's he saying? That we don't need teachers? No, that's not what he's saying. He's saying that the anointing from God is salvation. He's saying that you're saved and you can discern between truth and error. And so as we begin to read the text, I just want to put this together for you tonight. And then he begins to talk about how Jesus Christ is coming back. If you see chapter 2, verse 28, he says, Now little children, abide in him that when he appears. You know what that word appear means? It's a king coming to make a visit. When he appears. And so he begins to write this to them, and he says, at his coming, you know that he is righteous, and you know that everyone who practices righteousness is born of God. How many like waiting? How many in this room that enjoy? Man, some of you might say, you know what, John, I really like to wait. I would tell you, you are an anomaly, because I don't know very many people that like to wait. I'm one of them guys that go to Walmart, and when I have to. And when I go to Walmart, I'm looking for what? When I'm checking out, what am I looking for? The short line. I need the Holy Spirit to go to Walmart. And so I'm at Walmart, and there's these lines. And what am I doing? I got my shopping cart here, and I'm looking over the next aisle, and I'm hoping that if I take my shopping cart to the next aisle, that there ain't some little old lady shorter than the things on the aisle who has $500 worth of groceries she's putting on that thing, because I just lost my spot at aisle one to come over to aisle three because I don't like the wait. They made self-checkouts for people like me. Amen? I'll even check the fruit out. I'll type the numbers in on that thing so I don't have to wait. But Jesus is coming. We're called to wait. We're called to anticipate. And as John is writing these people, he's telling them that those who are born again are waiting on his appearing. And he's speaking of the love of God that he has bestowed on us to be called children of God. And there's two kinds of people here tonight. There's those that will be ashamed. Ashamed. And there's those that will be confident. There's not three kinds of people. There's lost people. And I'm not pointing at you for any reason. And they're saved people. There's people who are ready, and there's people who are not. There's two kinds. When's he coming? You got these people who make charts and maps, and they take numbers, and they do all this, and they make these big claims, and they put billboards up, and they say, Jesus is going to come back on this date. And guess what? They're all wrong. Jesus said, nobody knows. But there's signs of the times, Jesus says. Look at verse 18 in chapter 2. Little children, it is the last hour. And as you've heard, the Antichrist is coming. Even now, many Antichrists have come, by which we know that it is the last hour. The focus here is on the last hour. It has been the last hour ever since Jesus Christ was born and raised from the grave. It is the last hour in salvation history. Listen, friends, we don't have very much left on the calendar. And so no matter where you stand in the gospel, no matter what kind of view you have on the rapture or on the second coming of Jesus Christ, this is what I know. I know that there is a truth in the Bible. It says that Jesus Christ is coming back. The Bible says very clearly that there will be 7 years of tribulation. The Bible says like never seen before. The Bible says that there will be false peace from a man called the Antichrist or the lawless one, and this one will bring false peace. They will rebuild the temple. He will sit on that temple, and in my personal opinion, this man, all hell will break loose. The judgment that will be poured out in the book of Revelations will begin to happen, and at the end of the 7 years, Jesus Christ will come back. He will defeat the Antichrist, and he will rule and reign. And as I read this Bible, and as I see this, I believe that he's speaking of the rapture. That's me. I'm a rapture guy. Now, we can debate the secondary issues if we want, but this is what Thessalonians says about the rapture. 1 Thessalonians. Now, I'm going somewhere. Now, concerning the times and the season, brothers, you have no need to have anything written to you, for you yourselves fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 6. Then let us not sleep as others do, but let us keep awake and stay sober. What's he saying? He's saying that we need to be people who are anticipating the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. That we as Christians need to be looking towards him like he is coming as a thief in the night. If you knew that there was a thief coming in the middle of the night, brother, would you be waiting for him? Or would you just say, oh, it's okay, leave the door unlocked, you can do whatever you want to do, put all my valuables on the table, have my kids sleep next to the door? You would be suited and booted. You would be ready. You would be prepared because you know he is coming. And so as we study the book of John gives a series, 1 John gives a series of tests. Now, the theme of the book of 1 John is that you may know that you have eternal life. The Bible says that there is a way you can know. You don't have to worry. You don't have to wonder. You don't have to question your salvation, brothers and sisters. The Bible is clear that you can nail your salvation down and that you can know if you're saved. There's a series through the book of 1 John. And so as I read the book of 1 John, inside the theme, which is assurance, knowing that you're saved, there's these tests that he gives. And I call this the waiting test. This is the waiting test. What a day. What a day it will be for those who belong to Jesus Christ when he comes back. What a day. Woo! What a day. What a sad day it will be for those who have not trusted in Jesus as their Savior. 1 John chapter 3, verse 2. Beloved, we are children of God now, and what we shall be has not yet appeared. But when he appears, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. I'm here like John confessing my ignorance tonight. I don't know what I'm going to look like. But I'm going to be changed. I'm going to be changed into the image of Jesus Christ. I will have a glorified body. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. No more pain. No more aches. No more sin. I will be pure. I will be holy. I will be righteous. I will be sanctified. I will be as he is when I see him. Whoa, it's all worth it, brothers and sisters. Can I encourage you tonight? It's worth waiting on Jesus. And so the first test as I study this text, if I can find my clicker. Those who wait are living for Jesus while they wait. They live for Jesus while they wait. Look at verse 28. Here's a clear text right here that shows you this. Verse 28 says, these things I've written to you, and now, verse 28, and now, little children, look what it says. If you got a Bible and you got a pen, you can circle this word. It says, abide. Abide in him. Abide in him. That when he appears, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. If you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone who practices righteousness is born of him. Abide is used five times from verse 24 to verse 28. The word abide is used over and over again. And it speaks of abiding in Jesus Christ. And you may say, well, what does abide mean? Abide is a word that means to stay in one place. Abide is a word that means to wait for someone by remaining in a state of expectation for a future event. Abiding means to live in, to rest in. Let me just give you a couple texts where you can see where I'm going. Same word. Verse 27, Acts chapter 27, verse 31. Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, unless these men stay in the ship, they cannot be saved. Acts 20, verse 5, these went on ahead and were waiting on us in Troas. So when you see the word abide and when you see it used here in the text, he's saying wait, stay, position yourself in Jesus Christ. What am I trying to say? I am trying to say that those who wait on Jesus Christ live a life expecting him to come back. They're living a life expecting him to come back. They're living a life that honors Jesus Christ. And you say, well, how can that be? It's because they're born again and they have the power of the Holy Spirit that convicts them of sin. And they're studying the word and they're praying to God and they're seeking him and they're sharing the gospel and they're working out their own salvation with fear and trembling because they're waiting on his coming back. When I went to Cape Town for the first time, a matter of fact, Pastor Dave helped me go there. Pastor Dave Gidcombe brought a South African pastor to Freeway, and he asked me if I'd come preach revival, and I said, well, how much does it cost to get to South Africa and back? And he gave me a number, and I said, well, we don't have that kind of money. And Pastor Dave said, come preach revival at my church, and we'll take an offering and send you there. So I went, and me and my wife went to South Africa, and I met this guy named Greg Craig, and Greg Craig has a testimony like mine and many of yours, but Greg was a meth addict, and he took his meth and his meth pipe and he put it on the altar and he walked away from that life and he was saved and living for Jesus. And so I came up with an idea, let's try to do a discipleship program in South Africa. And so we raised some money and we flew Greg to Springfield from South Africa. And so everybody said I had a little bitty house, and everybody said, John, you need to put him in a hotel. I had teenage boy Chase, Keith, who was 9 at the time, and my wife in a 3-bedroom house, okay? 2 bathrooms. It was a small little house. And there was no room for him. But as I thought about this, I said, I want to make him feel loved. He's going to be with me for over 2 weeks, okay? I'm going to move this guy in my house. And so we made a place for Greg in the house. We gave him one of the bedrooms. And when Greg got off the airplane, I just want to explain something about South Africa. South Africa had just come out of apartheid not too long ago. And so racism is huge there, okay, big time. And so when Greg got off the plane all by himself from South Africa, the first thing he was doing is looking for somebody of his own color, okay? He's not white. He gets off the airplane in Springfield. He doesn't see anybody of his color. And he's nervous. But what he didn't know is we were waiting on him. I got a little boy named Keith. He's 9 years old and he don't know a stranger. He's not 9, but he was then. He's almost 12. He doesn't know a stranger. I talked all about Greg to Keith, and we made this big sign. And it said, welcome to the United States, Greg Craig. And me and Keith and Charlotte were standing there at the airport. And Keith had that sign and he's smiling. He's waiting. I showed him what he looked like on the phone, a picture of him. So he's looking, everybody that comes, Keith's looking. He's making sure it ain't this guy. And he's got this big sign and he's waiting and he's waiting and he's waiting and he's holding. And then all of a sudden, here comes Greg. Keith laid eyes on Greg. He threw the sign down, and he ran at Greg as fast as he could, and he jumped into his arms, and he embraced him like he'd known him his whole entire life. And at that moment, my son doesn't have a racist bone in his body. We don't play that at my house. And at the moment, Greg knew that he was going to be okay. Greg knew that we loved him and we were waiting on him. Now, let me ask you a question tonight. Is there evidence that we were waiting? Yeah. There was. Because we were watching. We had a sign. We were staying in the place we were supposed to be in. I can tell who's waiting tonight. By watching your life. I can tell who's anticipating the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ by how you are waiting on the Lord. When I look into the life of someone, I can tell if they know Christ most of the time by how they wait. I can tell by how they wait. Look what the Bible says. If you do not know, if you know that he is righteous, you may be sure that everyone who practices righteousness is what? What Jesus saying in Luke 6:46, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and don't do the things which I say? Who calls Jesus Lord? Do Buddhists call Jesus Lord? Do Muslims call Jesus Lord? Do atheists call Jesus Lord? Christians and people who think they're Christians call Jesus Lord. But here in the text, very clearly, he says that they don't know him. Later on, you'll see in Luke, he says that depart from me, you workers of iniquity, I never knew you. And so those who wait on the Lord are actively anticipating the Lord coming. You can tell that they are living for the Lord. They are practicing righteousness because they are born of God. You can tell they have a divine nature from God. They take after God. They're living like their Father. The nature of Jesus Christ is inside of them, and you can see. And the second thing is this. Those who wait on the Lord experience his love. Experienced his love. Look what it says in verse 1 of chapter 3. Behold, that word is an amazing, it's like being amazed. It's like when your hair is blown back, you know. He's saying, behold, it's an amazing, whoa, right? That's what he's saying. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God. Therefore, the world does not know us because it did not know him. Beloved, now we are children. He's saying, this is who you are. Right now, you are a children of God. You are a child of God. And so those who know Jesus Christ, those who are waiting on him, are people who have experienced the love of Christ. Let me ask you a question tonight. How did you come to saving faith in Jesus? How did you come to know the Savior? How did you become a Christian? God didn't save you because you were a good person. God didn't save you because you were seeking him. God didn't save you because you come from a good family. God saved you because you're unlovable. In spite of your unlovableness, even if that isn't a word, God saved you. Listen, what manner of love is this? What manner of love is this? John just drives the pen. He scoots his seat back. And he says, what manner of love? What manner of love is this? God brings salvation to the unlovable, the unworthy. His love pursues you and me. God's love is not something he just contains. God's love is involved in a visible transformation in the people who receive his love. Listen to me. God's love changed my life. God's love is, it's not like if I love you and no matter what, how much I love you, you just stay the same. No, God's love pursues you and it changes who you are. And so when the Apostle John writes this letter, he says, what manner of love is this? Listen, I'm family. In the family of God. What manner of love is this? Listen, I can understand about God loving you. But me? I know me. I know what I've done in my life, and I'm not proud of it. He loves me? An enemy of God? Somebody who lived a wretched life? What did I do to deserve? Did I go looking for Jesus? No. Did I pursue him? Are you kidding me? His love pursued a homeless needle junkie named John Stroop and saved me from a lifelong addiction to methamphetamines, cocaine. Listen, you don't understand the love of God. What manner of love is this? Some of you, when you see me, you look at me like, what jail cell did he crawl out of? But I'm going to tell you something tonight. I'm your brother in Christ, and there ain't a thing you can do about it.
We're family. We're family. What manner of love? What manner of love is this? I don't understand this love. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for who? Ungodly. Don't sugarcoat who you are. You're a filthy, rotten sinner, a natural-born sinner shaking his fist and her fist at God, and on your own, you are depraved and on your way to hell until you meet the Savior and he pursues you with your love. Listen, you are ungodly. He died for the ungodly. There are no good people. Verse 7, for one will scarcely die for a righteous person. Though perhaps for a good person would one dare to die, but God shows his love for us that while we are still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore, having been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath to come. For if we were enemies, an enemy, he died for his enemies. Before you can meet Jesus as your Savior, you have to meet him as your enemy. You have to realize that you are a lawbreaker. And on your own accord, you are on your way to hell, friend. And until you realize that, you can't come to Christ. You have to repent of your sins and trust in him by faith. For while if we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. This is a trustworthy saying and deserving of full acceptance. Christ came into the world to save good Baptists. Christ came into the world to save the Pentecostal. Christ came into the world to save those who've never been to jail. Christ came into the world to save those who give their money. Christ came into the world to save the good, the old, the sick, the lame, the mute, the blind. Christ came into the world to save sinners, of who I am the worst. That's a love I don't get. What manner of love is this? Being a Christian is not just a title. Being a Christian makes you a member of the family of God. What manner of love is this, Justin, that he'd save you as a dope fiend? Shaking your fist at God. What manner of love is this? I don't get it. We wait. We experience the love. We've been born of God. We've been born of God. Those who wait on Jesus have been born of God and have experienced his love. The last point is this. Those who wait grow more and more into his image. Tonight, are you living for the Lord? Can I look at your life and say, you know what? That brother is a Christian because he's got a My Lifeguard Walks on Water t-shirt on. He's got to be a Christian. That sister is a Christian because she wears a necklace that has a cross on it. Or can I look at your life without your necklace, without your confession, without your bracelet, and say that person is living for Jesus? Have you experienced the love of God? Listen. And are you growing more and more into the image of Jesus Christ? You should not be the same place you were at last year as a Christian. You remember when John the Apostle seen Jesus in a glorified body? Who remembers that? John the Apostle was deemed the apostle that Jesus loved. And he was very close to Christ. He has a very unique relationship with Jesus Christ. And he was told to take care of Jesus' birth mother. And so Jesus had three homeboys, James, John, and Peter. And he took them places that he didn't take anyone else. And so the Apostle John, when he writes the book of Revelation, realized that he was close to Jesus in the flesh. But when he sees Jesus in a glorified state, look what happens. Maybe. All right. There we go. This is Jesus glorified. In his right hand he held seven stars, and from his mouth he had a sharp two-edged sword. And his face was like the shining of the full strength of the sun. When I saw him,
I fell at his feet as I was dead. Now, I want you to think about that. Now, look at it again. Look at 1 John 3 again. Let me read this to you. Now, look at what he says. Look at Jesus, glorified. Now, look what he says in 1 John. We'll start at verse 1, chapter 3. We're almost done. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God. Therefore, the world does not know him because it did not know him. Know us because it did not know him. Beloved, we are now children of God. Now, it has not been revealed what we shall be. But we do know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him. We shall see him as he is. And everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself as he is pure. Now, let me just give you something to think about. He's not saying we're going to be little gods, okay? If you're a Mormon tonight, your theology is wrong and you are in error. That is not true. He's saying that you will be changed into his image. You'll have a glorified body. You'll see him as he is. You'll be like him. But here's the point John is making. He who hopes in this makes himself pure as he is pure. He's changing into the image of Jesus now. I'm hoping into the image. I'm thinking about Jesus. Is Jesus pure? Is Jesus holy? Is Jesus without sin? And so as I'm hoping in Jesus, and as I'm meditating on Jesus, and as I'm studying about Jesus, and the Holy Spirit is inside of me, I am beginning to grow more and more as a man of God, as a mature person, into the image of Jesus Christ now. My life is changing. I am not the same Christian as I was last year. I was not the Christian last year as I was the year before. Listen, holiness is something that preachers run from today. Don't preach holiness. Don't preach against sin. Don't preach repentance. Don't preach about hell. Listen to me, ladies and gentlemen. We need to be people who are fully submitted to God, who are people who repent of sin and trust in God, confess sin, live holy lives, and chase after God as fast as I can, hit the altar and say, God, if there's any hidden thing in me, cleanse me from this unrighteousness. I want to walk as close to you as I can. Look, my salvation has nothing to do with me. But my progressive sanctification is the work of the Holy Spirit and my obedience. You say, preacher, can you prove that? I want you to prove that with Scripture. I will. I'll prove it in Scripture right now. Look. Since we have these promises, this is somebody waiting on the Lord. Beloved, let us cleanse ourselves. This word pure, is it's either two things. It's moral purity or ceremonial purity. It's either cleansing yourself morally, holiness, or it's ceremonial purity. And he's not talking about being in a temple and being washed. Beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from every defilement of the body and spirit, bringing holiness to completion in the fear of God. James 4:8, draw near to God. Who's doing that? You are. Draw near to God, and he'll draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Who's he talking to? He's talking to the church. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22, having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth, for a sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart. What a day it will be when we see the face of Jesus. I want to claim my ignorance in that tonight and just say, just like John did, I don't know what I'll be like. I don't know what he'll be like, but guess what? I'll see him as he is. I'll be changed into the image of Jesus. Woo! What a day! What a day. I feel the need tonight to just encourage you. Do you know Jesus as your Savior? Are you anticipating his coming? Are you waiting on him? 2 Corinthians 3:17. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom. And we all with unveiled faces, like Moses had a veil, right? But unveiled, that's my words. Behold the glory of the Lord. They were beholding the glory of the Lord and being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Righteous living doesn't cause you to be saved and born again, but righteous living is the evidence of your being born again. I like what Atkins says. Daniel Atkins, I quote, "He is our pattern. We're not to judge our lives by other people, but by Christ, who is the standard or the goal towards which we are all to move. When he refers to pure, he's referring to cleanliness and holiness of our life. Are you waiting in anticipation for the Lord? I hope you're ready, Christian. I hope you're ready, lost person. If you don't know Jesus Christ tonight, listen to me. Trust in the sacrifice. He lived a sinless life. He was prophesied all through the Old Testament. He came to his own received him not, but to those who did receive him, he gave the right or the power to be called children of God. Jesus raised from the grave on the third day. Even atheists, historians who are worth anything know there's a literal Jesus who literally was crucified and literally buried in a tomb. And nobody knows where the body is. You know why? Because he rose from the grave. And he sits at the right hand of God. And he came to save the ungodly. You and me. Would you bow your heads tonight? I ask that our altar workers would be prepared. Music team would come. Every head down, every eye closed, please. In the front of the room on the right is our VIP section. For our VIP friends upstairs, that's where they meet with God. If they want to respond to the invitation, that's their section. Everywhere else belongs to everyone else. I hope tonight that you're ready when he comes. I pray that you're meditating and pondering on Jesus. I hope you belong to him. I hope when I look at your life or you look at your life, you can say, I have evidence that I know Jesus personally. Christian, are you living for the Lord? Have you experienced his life-changing love? Are you growing into the image of glory? Maybe you're here tonight and you don't know the Lord. You need to be saved. I would encourage you just to come to the altar tonight, get on your face and say, God, make yourself real to me. I want to trust in you tonight. Don't you dare come if you're not convicted. Don't you dare come just because I'm saying come. Come because God's all over you right now. So I'm going to pray. I feel like God's going to move in this place. Father, I pray, Lord, that you would just bless this altar call. I pray for those in this place that are far from you, Lord, that have been struggling with their salvation. They may have said a prayer one time and it was an empty, repeated prayer thing. And Father, they no more know you now than they did then. Their life shows no evidence. Father, if there's somebody here tonight that has an empty, shallow, hard-to-follow Christian testimony, I pray tonight, Lord, they know who they are, that they would come and let us help them nail this down. Father, I pray for the Christian. There's such thing as a baby Christian. I pray for that baby Christian, the one that just has not been growing. They've allowed sin to creep in their life. They're struggling, Lord. And right now they're not living for you. I just pray, God, that they would come and they would begin to just confess and repent and forsake that life, Lord, and just ask you for the power of the Holy Spirit to overcome those things, to get rid of those things, and maybe leave a relationship like Justin was talking about. But would you do a work in this place, God, whatever it is you've laid on these people's hearts? Something that can't be made or manufactured by me or men. In Jesus' name, amen.